Namo Vishnupadaya Krishna Pastam Vitalisya Mate Bhakti Vinata Swamiti Namini Namaste Sarasvata Devi Gauravani Pacharane Nirvishesha Sinyavadi Pachkachai Desatarane Omakyana Timandasya Tananja Slaka Saksarangitam Yena Tasmahi Sikove Namaha. So, we will discuss, continue to discuss the sixth chapter of the seventh canto. Prahlad instructs his demoniac schoolmates that. So, Prahlad Maharaj is launching his attack against the materialistic education. And materialistic education, which educates one to forget the purpose of life. Because he's so deeply internally engaged in his relationship with Krishna, he's even not experiencing the enmity of his father who is trying to kill him. Is not experiencing any fear or exhibiting any pride. So, Prahlad Maharaj is preaching here very much against the materially attached life. Text 9. Go krihe supamam saktam atmanam Achitandriyaha Sneyapas Paser Prider Padam Utsaita Vimochitum. So Prahlad Maharaj has already described the beginning of life as illusioned the first 20 years. First 20 years spent in frivolous activities, and also 20 years at the end of life, caught up in miseries, absorbing one's entire consciousness that is working now on the middle years. The middle years, the years between, they are concerned with absorption in family life, absorption in children, career, etc. But Prahlad Maharaj is not speaking about devotees here. He's speaking about Kriyamedi life. Devotees, they are working under the guidance of sadhus. No, but at the same time, he's pointing out to tendencies that we are struggling with. That I read the translation of text 9. What person too attached to household life due to being unable to control his senses can liberate himself? An attached householder is bound very strongly by ropes of affection for his family, for his wife, children, and other relatives. That, so, life purpose is to liberate one from materialistic life and to become attached to Krishna. This attachment, thinking one in relationship with family instead of Krishna, what's the result of that? Prahlad described that before. Ananda Gobir. That uncontrolled senses. That. So. I will now read from the middle of the second paragraph. Prahlad Maharaj explained to his father that to be freed from all anxieties, one should go to the forest. It fatma patam shayam andakupam. One should give up his household, which is a place for going further and further down into the darkness region of material existence. The first advice, therefore, is one that must give up household life, shayam andakupam. However, if one prefers to remain in the dark well of household life because of uncontrolled senses, it becomes increasingly entangled by ropes of affection for his wife, children, servants, house, money, and so on. Such a person cannot again attain liberation from material bondage. Therefore, children should be taught from the very beginning of life to be first-class brahmacharis. Then it will be possible for them to give up household life in the future. So the material world is like a prison. How can you get out of the prison if you are attached to the prison bars? This is a story of a devotee many years ago, an Indian devotee, and he was from a pious Brahmin family. And his grandmother, she was a widow, she was very devoted to Krishna. And one day she comes into the house and she put a white blanket up the ground. And she lied down and she told everyone, chant Radhe Shyam. And one of her sons started to cry. She said, bring him away to the next room. And they continued chanting Radhe Shyam. And she left her body. Interesting is she knew she was going to leave her body. And she would not allow someone to cry at that moment. She said, bring him to the next room. Otherwise, that attachment may come out when you leave your body. So that was many years ago. Queen Kunti, in the 8th chapter of the first canto, she prays to Lord Krishna, please cut this skin affection for my sons, the Pandavas. One can say our sons were devotees. It's good to be attached to them. Srila Prabhupada, in a purport, he writes that Queen Kunti is not praying for taking away to her attachment to her sons as devotees, but no, she's not praying to take away the finer feelings of affection. But she's praying away to Krishna, please take away the skin affection, thinking they are my sons, therefore are related to me. So you should see our own children, not as our children, as Krishna's children. And we have the service to educate them. See everyone as a part and parcel of Krishna. So she was speaking about the material part of the relationship. Cut my affection for the Pandavas, the skin relationship. At the time of death, we need to fly our own airplane. Prahlad Maharaj was living always in his relationship with Krishna. From that perspective, one can speak in a very blunt way about the materialistic way of life. Also, for devotees, material affection can be very strong. Can be very strong. If you have children, then you are worried about them until you die. That naturally, by that affection, there is an intertwining of karma. Therefore, Prahlad Maharaj said to his father, "You should go to the Vana, the forest, and take shelter of Hari, of Krishna. Don't take shelter of your family members. You need to break all the other shelters." That you have the sannyas mantra, etamsa astaya, paratmanistam. With great faith in paramanista, paramatmanistam. The tamsa astaya paratmanistam, atyasna purvatamermarsipi. Ham tari sama duranta param tamom kundangi nisheva shiva. The Avanti Brahman prays, whatever it takes, but with great faith in the Lord, Paramatmanista, I will get over this ocean of material existence, whatever it takes. That so Paramatma is some faith should be in the Lord. That we read the last paragraph of text 9 purport. To return home, back to Godhead, one must be completely free from material attachment. Therefore, Bhakti Yoga means Vairagya Vidya, the art that can help one develop a distaste for material enjoyment. And then Srila Prabhupada quotes this verse of the second chapter of the first canto, verse 7. Vasudevi Bhagavati Bhakti Yoga Prayochita Yanyatya Sivarahyam Yanamsa Yet a high to come. By rendering the voice of service unto the personality of Goddess Krishna, one immediately acquires causeless knowledge and detachment from the world. If one engages in the voice of service from the beginning of life, he easily attains Vairagya Vidya, or Shakti detachment, and becomes Sitendriya, the controller of his senses. One who perfectly engaged in the voice of service is therefore called Gosvami or Swami, master of the senses. Unless one is the master of the senses, he should not accept renounced order of life. The strong indication for sense enjoyment is the cause of the material body. Without full knowledge, one cannot be attached to material enjoyment. But as long as one is not in that position, one is not fit to return home back to Godhead. So Prahlad Maharaj is instructing his schoolmates on the uselessness of the materialistic way of life. It is all phantasmagoria. It is something we think as substantial, but when we are leaving the body, there is no substance. One must become completely free from material attachment by learning this art on how to become completely attached to Krishna. When he is attached to Krishna, becomes attached from this material world. And this is the only way to become really detached from this material world, by cultivating attachment to Krishna. And that's the life purpose, of course. There is also the factor of mercy there. We need to do our part, cultivating the attachment from the material world and attachment to Krishna. So, because complete knowledge is beyond aham brahmasmi. Aham brahmasmi, the knowledge of I'm a spirit soul, that's not sufficient. We must know who we are. We are a servant of Krishna, part of Krishna. And we must know what our natural activity is, devotional service. So it's complete knowledge is beyond Brahmasmi. Only, when we are in full knowledge of Krishna and take shelter of him, then we are secure. For this, we need a higher taste. We are not fit. And by the mercy, we may get knowledge by mercy. But we have to do our part. Now, text 10. Konvarta Trishnam Vishichet Pranabhyo Piya Ipsita Yam Krinat Yasubi Pastai Taskara Sevaku Vanek. Money is so dear that one conceives money as being sweeter than honey. Therefore, who can give up the desire to accumulate money, especially in household life? Thieves, professionals, soldiers, and merchants try to acquire money even by risking their very dear lives. So it is that love makes the world go around, but money greases the wheels. In the material world is the golden rule. One who has money, he rules. He has the power. Lakshmi, money, is the medium by which one can fulfill all one's desires in this world, material desires. Yeah. It is said that the sadhu should not accept money which comes from sinful activities. So, in the Bhagavad Gita, we have charity in the mode of goodness performed, given out of duty, no expectation of return at the proper time and places to a worthy person is considered to be in the mode of goodness. So, it is said the sadhu should not receive money from sinful activities, not accepting money from those who are not giving out of duty and so on. So we should accept only money from someone who thinks that money has been given to me for the service of Krishna. So there are great souls who have wealth and think in this way. That's a Vaishnava. So Srila Prabhupada speaks about that in many lectures. Like Gargashodas Babaji, he had nothing a begging bowl. But Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvatma said he was going to preaching destination in cars. He had temple, he had marble temples that so let's read the purport of Srila Prabhupada that read first lines. How money can be dearer than life is indicated in this verse. Thieves may enter the house of a rich man to steal money at risk of their lives. Because of trespassing, they may be killed by guns or attacked by watchdogs, but still they try to commit burglary. Why do they risk their lives only to get some money? Similarly, a professional soldier is recruited into the army and he accepts a service with the risk of dying on the battlefield only for the sake of money. In the same way, merchants go from one country to another on boats at risk of their lives, and they dive into the water of the sea to collect pearls and valuable gems. This is practically proven, and everyone will admit that money is sweeter than honey. One may risk everything to acquire money, and for this, this is especially true of rich men who are too attached to household life. So this is very heavy to hear. That this, it's a point of warning for us, risking our lives for the sake of money. And now we have text 11:13 speaks about sweetness in household life. How can a person who is most affectionate to his family, the core of his heart being always filled with their pictures, give up their association? Specifically, a wife is always very kind and sympathetic and always pleases her husband in a solitary place. Who could give up the association of such a dear and affectionate wife? Small children talk in broken language, very pleasing to hear, and their affectionate father always thinks of their sweet words. How could he give up their association? One's elderly parents and one's sons and daughters are also very dear. A daughter is especially dear to her father, and while living at her husband's house, she is always in his mind. Who could give up that association? Aside from this, in household affairs, there are many decorated items of household furniture, and there are also animals and servants. Who could give up such comforts? A Dutch household is like a silkworm. It weaves a cocoon in which it becomes imprisoned, unable to get out simply for the satisfaction of two important senses, the genitals and the tongue. One is bound by material conditions. How can one escape that? So Prahlad Maharaj here is warning. This is not actual life. That actual life is living in a relationship with Krishna. If one is attached in this way, one does not desire to give it up, and there is no question of spiritual life. But the human life offers such an opportunity to regaining one's relationship with Krishna. The tendency in material life is only if I had that, of yeah, only if I had love for the Bhagavatam. Only if I have devotion. Yeah. Only if I had done this or that, but this comes from desires. It takes many lives to learn this. What we want, we will get. We should make sure that the primary goal of life should not be overshadowed by other desires. Material life is built just to entangle us in a network. That therefore, those who are devotionally inclined should carefully develop one's attachment. One's attachment for Krishna. So this attachment, cultivation of attachment, is required to escape from any other form of material consciousness. That we need to understand the real material nature and cultivate our attachment to Krishna in association of devotees. Text 14. One who is too attached cannot understand that he is wasting his valuable time, his valuable life for the maintenance of his family. He also fails to understand that the purpose of human life, a life suitable for realization of the absolute truth, is being imperceptibly spoiled. However, he very cleverly is attentive to seeing that not a single farthing is lost by mismanagement. Thus, although an attached person in material existence always suffers from the threefold miseries, it does not develop a distaste for the way of material existence. So that it is said here before. He also fails to understand that the purpose of human life, a life suitable for realization of the absolute truth, is being imperceptibly spoiled. Imperceptibly means invisible. That, yes. It is said we have heard in the second canto, 2.3.17, Ayur arati vaipum sam utyam astam sayannasa. Das yachte yat ksanonita utamasloka vartai. Just by rising of the sun, by setting of the sun, your life duration is decreased for everyone, except one who utilizes discussing topics of the all good personality of Godhead. So that means for materialists, the rising and setting of the sun is another day lost. It signifies that at the end of the last day, and for devotees, it is an opportunity to engage in the service of Krishna. Yeah. If one is too attached, one is wasting his life. He's telling his schoolmates, do not become like this. Text 15. If a person too attached to the duties of family maintenance is unable to control his senses, the core of his heart is immersed in how to accumulate money. Although he knows that one who takes the wealth of others will be punished by the law of the government and by the laws of Yamaraj after death, he continues cheating others to acquire money. Text 16. Oh, my friend, son of demons, in this material world, even those who are apparently advanced in education have the propensity to consider this is mine and this is for others. Thus, they are always engaged in providing the necessities to their families in a limited conception of family life, just like uneducated cats and dogs. They are unable to take to spiritual knowledge. Instead, they are bewildered and overcome by ignorance. So here, Danucha, sons of demons, Prahlad says, the purport, I will read from six lines down, when Sanatana Goswami submitted to the lotus feet of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, his first question was, Ke ami, kene amaya jari tapa traya? In other words, he wanted to know his constitutional position and why he was suffering from the threefold miseries of material existence. This is the process of education. If one does not ask, who am I? What's the goal of my life? But instead, follows the same animal propensities as cats and dogs, what is the use of his education? As discussed in the previous verse, a living entity is entrapped by his fruitive activities, exactly like a silkworm trapped in his own cocoon. Foolish persons are generally engaged by their fruitive actions, karma, because of a strong desire to enjoy this material world. Such attracted persons become involved in society, community, and nation and waste their time, not having profited from having obtained human forms. Especially in this Kali Yuga, great leaders, politicians, philosophers, and scientists are all engaged in foolish activities, thinking this is mine and this is yours. The scientists invent nuclear weapons and collaborate with the big leaders to protect the interests of their nation or society. In this verse, however, it is clearly stated that despite their so-called advanced knowledge, they actually have the same mentality as cats and dogs. As cats, dogs, and other animals, not knowing their true interest in life, becomes increasingly involved in ignorance, the so-called educated person who does not know his own self-interest or the true goal of life becomes increasingly involved in materialism. Therefore, Prahlad Maharaj advises everyone to follow the principles of Varnashram. Specifically, at a certain point, one must give up family life and take to the renounced order of life to cultivate spiritual knowledge and thus become liberated. This is further discussed in the following verses. Then text 17, 18. So, my dear friends, son of demons, it is certain that no one bereft of knowledge of the Supreme Personality of Godhead has been able to liberate himself from material bondage at any time or in any country. Rather, those bereft of the Lord are bound by the material laws. They are factually addicted to sense gratification, and their target is women. Victimized by such a conception of life, they become surrounded by children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and thus they are shackled to material bondage. Those who are very much addicted to this conception of life are called demons. Therefore, although you are sons of demons, please keep aloof from such persons and take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Narayan, the origin of all the demons, because the ultimate goal for the devotees of Narayan is liberation from the bondage of material existence. So that's, yeah. The verse says they become playthings in the hands of attractive women. That they want to exploit women and end up to be exploited by women. Yeah. Why are they called demons? Because they put themselves in the center. And they avoid Krishna's supremacy. This is the essence of demonic consciousness, being ultimately selfish. It's also in the Bhagavatam, there are two kinds, and the Bhagavad-gita also, there are two kinds of living entities, the devotees and the demons. Where do we fit in? Trying to cross the dividing line? What is the dividing line? What is our shelter? If only Krishna is your shelter, then you are a devotee. That we must make Krishna our only shelter. Not our family, not our money. That is a very dangerous attachment. So one must leave behind this phantasmagoria of the material world. So Krishna consciousness means learning the art of Sharanagati, of taking shelter of Krishna. Yeah. It means coming to the point that whatever happens to me, let it happen. Saranagati. Just think how Krishna deals with his devotees who are surrendered to him. That he becomes the property of such devotee. And us. And that attitude of surrender, it's a down payment to go to Goloka Vrindavan. Krishna said to the gopis, Napayeham, I cannot repay you. Please be satisfied with your own service, that I will never be able to repay you for your love and devotion. So, what can be safer than Krishna, who takes care of you? In this purport, which we just heard, Srila Prabhupada is comparing the scientist, the materialist, as cats and dogs, chewing the chewed, he will say in the purport. We will read this purport to end. That Prahlad Maharaj has maintained the philosophical point of view that one should give up the dark well of family life and go to the forest to take shelter of the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It Fatma Padam Hyamanda Kupan Vanam Ghatriya Dharimasrayita. In this verse also, it stresses the main point. In the history of human society, no one at any time or any place has been liberated because of too much affection and attachment for his family. Even in those who are apparently very educated, the same family attachment is there. Therefore, give up the association of their families, even in old age or invalidity, for they are attached to sense enjoyment. As we have several times discussed, so-called householders are simply attached by sexual enjoyment. Thus they keep themselves shackled in family life. And furthermore, they want their children to be shackled in the same way. Playing the parts of playboys in the hands of women, They glide down to the darkness region of material existence. Because they are unable to control their senses, they continue a life of chewing the chewed, and therefore they descend to the darkness regions of material, the darkest material regions. One should give up the association of such demons and adhere to the association of devotees. Thus, one will be liberated from material bondage. So this was this section of today, the second section. Now, Mother Kasturika, she sent me a question in the chat. Srila Prabhupada emphasizes simple living and high thinking in 223 purport, that even in the midst of difficulty, one doesn't budge to sacrifice this principle. When he asked one senior devotee, he told this is applicable only to sannyasis, as they are completely dependent on the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But Srila Prabhupada never said it's for sannyasis. So how can we apply? Here Prahlad is teaching the same principle. So, yes, that's simple living and high thinking is very conducive for spiritual advancement. And yes, it's for everyone. This simple living and this high thinking. We have the example of Sudam. Sudam was very poor, and his wife asked him to go to see Krishna in Dwarka. And we see finally Sudam comes in Dwarka, is received by Krishna, put on his bedstead. And offered all respects, foot washing, so on. And what did they do? They spoke about their past experience at the Gurukul. There was an exchange of love and affection. And finally, Sudam did not ask anything. But Krishna knew his desire and the desire of his wife. He fulfilled all his desires. When he came back, he found a big palace. But there, it is said that Sudam continued living as before, very simple. That he was not attached to on this palace. So that shows a devotee lives simple. Even in the greatest opulence, he lives simple and high thinking, yes. Always absorption in Bhagavad Gita, the Bhagavatam, speaking about Krishna. A pure devotee never gives that up. He cannot engage in sense gratification. So better to live simple. We have also spoken about this Brahmin a few lessons ago, who was very poor, and a landowner came and said, "You are so poor, I want to give you something." And the Brahmin said, "I don't need anything. My students bring me some rice, and I have here leaves from a tamarind tree, and I'm eating very nicely, thank you. I have everything what I need." So it's more the inner attitude that I'm satisfied with a simple way of living, even in the greatest opulence. That if a devotee gets opulence, yes, he does not use that for his own, but he will use that in his service. So he remains simple living and high thinking, even in the greatest opulence. But for that you have to be certain purity in heart. and the heart is not pure, then one will become attached. And that danger is there, and that's what Prahlad Maharaj is explaining here. Be careful with that. That, yeah, better to be poor if you are still attached. So, this section, I've no specific questions. It's all mainly on the same topic. The dangers of family attachment, household life, money, that these are killers of the soul if we become attached. So are there any comments or questions, please? Is it clear for everyone how to apply this knowledge? I think there may be some challenges. What did we learn today? Yes, we learned 20 years, spoiled in the beginning of our life, 20 years, at the end of our lives, and Prahlad Maharaj said, be careful, what's between you could also spoil it. It makes us forget life's purpose. And that's the old society, the whole materialistic society. That everything was on the internet. It makes you forget life purpose. But we have Prahlad here. Prahlad, who had always on the, who could see the danger of this. Although he was always seeing Krishna every moment. A question of Rasalpa. How can a Brahmachari gain an understanding of household life without going to it? That reminds me of the story of Daksha. Daksha's he was a Prajapati, a powerful one. So he's first responsible for creating progeny for, and he created 10,000 sons, Asya Lasvas. He sent them to a river near to the Red Sea to do austerities. And to prepare for Gyastha life. And at that time, Narada Muni came. And he saw, these are nearly liberated. Let me give them a little push. And he told them a story. In a country, there is one country, there is one king, and in this country, there's a man living in a house, and the wife in the house changes dresses to attract his mind. And then there is a river which flows in two directions, up and down. But at the end of the river, there is a razor blade that destroys everything. After hearing that story in the Hasyalasvas, they understood material life is useless. It's like a man living in a house in his body, And he thinks himself the king of that. And his mind makes proposals for son's enjoyment, like a wife changes dresses. And by that, he's going up into fruitive activities, up and down on the river, on the material river. And at the end, he's going to the razor blade. Everything is destroyed. So all these Asyalasvas, because they did austerities, they had some control over the senses. They were receptive for that knowledge. And they decided all to take sannyas. And Daksha was furious. But then he created another 1,000 sons, the Sasyalasvas, and he sent them to the same place for austerity. And who came by again? Narada Muni. Did he tell the same story? No, he just said an older brother should follow in the footsteps of the younger brother. A younger brother should follow in the footsteps of their older brother. And they all understood that. They all took sannyas. And then when Narada Muni met Daksha cursed him. I curse you that you cannot stay more than 3 days in one place. You have lured my sons in immature renunciation, he said. Their renunciation is false, Daksha said, because that they should have gone to the experience of family life, and then knowing what it is, they can renounce, give it up. So that was Daksha's idea and Daksha's answer on your question. But Srila Prabhupada in the purport said, this is wrong, this is not so. One can get again that understanding of household life by hearing. Just by hearing about the miseries of household life. And by the miseries, I would say by the dangers of household life. Yeah. Danger that it brings one in misery. Yes. So by hearing this, the explanation of Prahlad Maharaj, we can gain an understanding of household life. It depends. Household life with devotees can be different. But when Mother Narayani went to this section, he asked all the devotees in the Bhaktivedanta course who were married or have been married, have you been successful in household life? Nobody said yes. A few said sometimes. So hearing that, you should understand. Household life is done out of duty to the spiritual master and as a service to Krishna. And best it's done without attachment. That's not easy. That's a very difficult position. But if the householder hears sufficient and has a sadhana and is serious, then household life will purify him and will become detached. That's the blessing. But experiencing is second class. Hearing is first class. Better, Srila Prabhupada gives that example. If someone hears that, stealing is bad, and by hearing, one refrains from it. That's first class. Second class is one sees One must first see that a thief is arrested before stopping the tendency for stealing. That's second class. Third class is one must himself steal and become arrested to learn. So what way of learning? Three levels. So that would be my answer to Ras Al Babu on his question, how can we gain an understanding of household life without going through it? Yes. Any other questions? So, Thibu Van Aert is actively participating, that is very good. Affairs of material relationship produce a temporary result. A relationship with the Lord, one gets permanent results with Prahlad. How to balance it? Yes. That's the answer is in nutshell, Yukta Varaja. Use the relationship in the service of Krishna. That experience that the point is that there will be always some attachment in family life, and that's honest, we cannot avoid it, but we should avoid extreme attachment. That's explained by the Avadhuta Brahman who gives the example of the 24 gurus. He learned from 24 gurus how to become liberated. And one story is the two birds that pigeons became very attached to each other. The male pigeon was so attached to the female pigeon. They did everything together, eating, sleeping, flying, seeking worms. So many things. But finally, the male pigeon could not control his senses. And then one day there were eggs and they built it and the eggs were put into the nest. And then little birds came out and they flew away, he and she pigeon, to get worms from them and feed them. But then one day a hunter came, and when the little birds' children tried to fly out, they were captured. And the mother pigeon came and she was also, her mind went blank. By that, she was easily captured by the hunter. And then a male pigeon came. Instead of thinking, oh, Krishna wants me to take sannyas, he thought, yes. He started to lament. Oh, my wife is everyone, my children. No life has no sense anymore. And he was also captured. So that is extreme attachment. Should be avoided at all cost. But attachment should be there. But at the same time, we can use the family relationships by together serving devotional service. Have deity worship at home. All food should be offered to the deities, that organize preaching programs. And there is a birthday of the child, organize a party with prasad and preach about Krishna consciousness. put every try to put everywhere Krishna in the center. Then it becomes different. We need to find out how to do that. And then, yes, the material relationship is used for preaching. And that will help us to purify us. So, my answer is avoid extreme attachment and use the existing attachment in Krishna's service. And that's how to balance this. And yeah, one can learn from the experience from those who have done that. There are many nice Shasta couples. Muridhar Syamprabhu, what can I do for you? Please speak.
Hare Krishna Maharaj.
Yeah.
Maharaj, in a third canto of Bhagavatam, there are pastime what Karadama Muni renounced. And even though son is a Kapila, now in our society, we have many old devotee and they're still attached to the family. How are we going to inspire them to join Varnash, this Vanaprastha in the temple to inspire them, Maharaj? When we see here Prahlad Maharaj was advising Hiranyakashipu to take a Vanaprastha. So how we going to how we can means I can inspire them to join Vanaprastha in the temple and do service, Maharaj.
Yeah,
because they was quoting to me, I'm doing Yukta Vairakya, but end up I see they was like too attached with their grandchildren, all this thing. So this is my question, Maharaj.
Yeah, that is a very noble idea to attract older hiastas, that maybe temples could organize programs especially for them. Srila Prabhupada's purpose of the guest house in Vrindavan was for them. Maybe that could be activated, that not right possible now with the pandemic, so we will have to be patient. But yes, that after 50 we should get out, and many will not, that they will remain attached. But of course, going, taking Vanaprastha, can done together with the wife, if facilities for that are created. So create facilities and promote it. That I would say these two things, but usually that is not the endeavor, an individual endeavor, but a communal endeavor. But yes, that need is there and it's part of Srila Prabhupada's mission. And there is a need in our movement very strongly to work on that. So, thank you very much. Good. That there are no further. Yeah, oh, Lalita Pitamaya. Please speak.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Maharaj, my doubt is regarding the first session of today's.
Yeah.
Yesterday I was reading the Science of Self-Realization book, and like what we read it today morning, the same thing was found. Srila Prabhupada was telling that the pleasure is already stored up in the body. So we don't need to endeavor, like work hard like an ass to make our sense gratification or to derive pleasure from those things. So I'm really not able to understand, like when we do certain things, we get results. And from that, we get this happiness or distress. So how is that? The pleasure is already planned or designed in the body. So how is that, Maharaj? I'm not able to understand.
You have the story of Vaikari, the hunter. He was killing these animals in a very cruel way. And Narada Muni, but he went to that forest and he saw all these animals half killed. Then he met Mihara the hunter. And Narada Muni said, can you do me a favor? And the hunter said, yes, what do you want? I can give you some deer skin or whatever. And Narada Muni said, no, I just want, please kill these animals completely. Don't let them suffer. And he gave him a vision how he will suffer because of that in the future. And then Mihara the hunter became convinced and he said to Narada Muni, so I want to get rid of this karma. Please tell me what to do. Yes, Narada Muni said, but first you have to give up your bow. Give up my bow, he said. That's my livelihood, I live from that. How will I live in the purpose? Srila Prabhupada writes that Mihara the hunter thinks that the results of his livelihood, his maintenance depends on his work, but it's not so. Our maintenance does not depend on his work. It's very clear. This is in Chaitanya Charitamrita. That means, yes, we can endeavor for something, but the result is already determined. Srila Prabhupada said, again, I repeat, there should be a minimum of endeavor. But it doesn't depend on our endeavor, but on our karma. And that's true. It depends on our. But to understand that is not easy with our material consciousness. It's like you take sannyas, you start traveling. You can think, how should I live? How should I pay my flight tickets and so on? Does that depend on my endeavor? No. I'm always worried. Am I going to be able to pay everything? Will I be able to continue preaching? But I receive always just enough money. And I continue. Does it depend on my result? No. Does it depend on my karma? Maybe, maybe not. That if you are under the spiritual energy, partially, there may be Krishna's mercy involved who arranges everything. And we see also Prahlad Maharaj, he did not worry about any of these things. That all happens. We have the example of Shivas. Shivas, he was not concerned about the maintenance of his family, and he had a big family. He was just chanting Hare Krishna, performing Sankirtan. But somehow or other, he got everything he needed. One day, Lord Chaitanya went to him and said, Shivas, what if one day the Lord does not maintain your family, does not give you any food? Shivas said, then that day we will fast, chant, and be happy. And he clapped three times in his hand. And Lord Chaitanya said, and the next day, if Krishna does not give you any food, Shiva said, we will fast that day, chant Hare Krishna and be happy. And then Lord Chaitanya said, if a third day Krishna does not give you food, then Shrivas said, then I will go with my family to the Ganga and we will drown ourselves. He had just this great faith, and Krishna maintained him everywhere. Krishna maintains all living entities. Why not us? That why us who want to become his devotee? That yes, to materialists, what Prahlad Maharaj is saying and what I'm saying here, it sounds utopia. And that's because they don't have knowledge. Knowledge comes by serving Krishna. That's the way to get knowledge. That and by that, yes, faith in Krishna. Faith moves mountains. That, but we have to still do our minimum endeavor, like everything belongs, like everything depends on us. But knowing very well, the results, good or bad, is Krishna's mercy. Hare Krishna. I hope this helps.
Maharaj, one small doubt in connection with this, Maharaj. Like if, for example, in a family life, if the husband is really very dedicated and he has a full faith that Krishna will protect him, and by chance, if his parents, like his elderly parents, are not having much faith on the Lord, and if there is some disturbance in the family life, so how should they handle those situations?
Who is they?
Like the person, the head of the family.
The devotee?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, okay. Okay. That, well, we would see, we should understand that we are only servant of the circumstances. The circumstances Krishna gives us. We must work within these parameters. That we are the servants of the circumstances that Krishna gives us. And Krishna is in charge of the circumstances. And Krishna must have some reason for that. We may not understand now, but that's the fate of the Buddha. Is that okay? Good, thank you. Then we continue tomorrow, when we will tomorrow end this chapter. Tomorrow there will be a few nice stories, very inspiring stories. I heard the class of Narayani Mataji and got a lot of inspiration from that. So look forward to be online again tomorrow, and we will finish then this chapter and go to questions, because there are a lot of more questions, but not related to the section of today. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Jai Prabhupada. Jai Prabhupada.